All right. Now, it was brought to my attention this morning, and again, it's good to have all the new people here. We're moving along pretty quick here now that we've gotten toward the end of the book of Revelation. It's taken us a while to get there. I don't even know how long we've been in it this time around, but it's definitely not going what you would call fast. And but it is going fast for some of the newer folks that have joined us. And it mentioned this morning about the second coming of Christ, and there was a little bit of confusion. I had the privilege of meeting with a couple of couples after church, and they were saying, we've never heard any of this before. Amen. And they were just not one of those kind of things they were bitter about, just nobody had ever showed them. Sure. And so when they sat down and got to talking about it, they had a multitude of questions, and I thought to myself, you know what I probably need to do is to let everybody know what the exact point and time that we're talking about. So what I want to do is this was a copy thing that was made. It's a little lighter than that other thing that we carry up here. If I can have a couple of fellas, let's do it. I guess I can get this on camera. Get a couple of you fellas to come up here and just pull that out. Brother Larry, you can come on up if you want to. I need to see you after church. And it's not quite as heavy. But for those of you that don't know what we're talking about, don't let the chart scare you. We're in Revelation chapter number 19. Revelation chapter number 19 has to do with the second coming. Now, as was brought to my attention this morning, a lot of people, when they talk about the second coming, they think you're talking about the rapture. The rapture is not the second coming. You could make it theologically a part of the second coming, but the rapture is not the second coming. The rapture, the Lord meets you in the air. He stops and levitates there above the sky, and then you come up to meet Him. The second coming is when the Lord comes down on the Mount of Olives, and when He splits that thing in the Mount of Olives here in Zechariah 14, then you have the Battle of Armageddon. So the time period we're going to talk about, or that we're talking about, is here. But just to let you know, we've come through the book of Revelation, and if you'll notice that the book of Revelation, this period called the Great Tribulation, takes place after a thing called the Church Age. Now, for those of you that know this already, just bear with me. I won't be long on it, but I want to just make sure that people understand where we are on the timeline. So all this has taken place already in history. Here comes Calvary right here. At the end of Calvary, they reject God in the Old Testament. After they reject God in the Old Testament, there's 400 years of silence. At the end of 400 years of silence, at the end of that particular time right there, then they reject, or Jesus Christ comes, they reject Him on Calvary. After they reject Him, 225 days later, they reject Stephen preaching about the Holy Ghost, and He says to them, "You stiff-necked and uncircumcised, you do always resist the Holy Ghost." At that point, three strikes, you're out. And that's why you got three strikes that you're out when you're playing baseball. But at any rate, they've done with that, and that's where the church starts. That's Acts chapter number 2. Gentiles don't get in until the first Gentile gets saved over there in Acts chapter number 8. Acts chapter number 9, that's the Ethiopian eunuch. Acts chapter number 9, the Apostle Paul is called out, but his message isn't clearly heard until Acts chapter 15. Now, don't worry if you don't get all of this, but I'm trying to get you to have an idea in your mind when you get to the book of Revelation where you are. And it's unfortunate that a lot of people read the Bible, but nobody ever takes the time to tell them what time events are there taking place. So, at the end of this thing called the church age, right here where Brother Daniels is standing, at the end of that thing comes a thing called the rapture. That's not the second coming. The second coming is over here at the end of the tribulation. That's important for you to know. If you're visiting here so that you understand clearly, here we are pre-tribulation. That means we believe the church goes out before the tribulation period. We believe that's a time of Jacob's trouble during what's called Daniel's 70th week. That's all to Israel. Now, if you're here and you're not a Jew, it's still going to fall on you, but the church is already gone. Don't let this scare you. A lot of people say, well, if you have dispensations, that there's something wrong with you, you're a cult or something, the Bible won't make sense to you unless you rightly divide it. Yeah. You rightly divide Old Testament and New Testament, don't you? Let me show you how easy it is. In the Old Testament, you couldn't eat anything with fins and scales. That means no catfish, no lobster, no shrimp, that kind of stuff. In the New Testament, every creature of God, 1 Timothy 4, is good. Nothing to be refused if it be received with prayer and thanksgiving. Do you understand? Now, in the Old Testament, I couldn't eat it. That's Levitical law. In the New Testament, things have changed. You understand where I'm saying? What you did was just make a division. In the Old Testament, you got to keep the law. In the last age here, right here, you got to keep the law. You got to do it. And if you can't keep the law, you got to bring a goat. You got to bring a lamb. You got to bring a ram. You got to bring a he-goat. You have to bring a turtle dove or whatever happens to be there and offer that as a sacrifice for your sins. After Jesus Christ dies, if you come to the Calvary, your sins are paid for in this area. You don't go back to the temple and offer a sacrifice. And you don't do like one religion does and offer him every week. Christ suffered once for sins. That means once you trust Jesus Christ, when you're taking the sacrament, what they call sacraments, we call it the Lord's Supper. He never calls it a sacrament. You don't take the Lord's Supper for salvation. You get that just as a testimony to remember his death until he comes. Now, so that you understand, this is the church age that takes place here, and you're right along in here somewhere. You're right toward the end of that time of the Lord Jesus Christ coming for his saints. That means those that are saved. That means nobody on the past back over here. That means nobody in the time over here, the future. That means just the people that are saved. That doesn't mean just Baptist. You understand? It has nothing to do with the denomination. We're denominational because it shows what we believe. But you're not denominational because only a certain group of a denomination goes to heaven. There'll be some Catholics in heaven. Amen. There'll be some Catholic, there'll be some Methodists there, there'll be some Charismatics there, there'll be some Pentecostals, there'll be just about everybody. You're not saved by a denomination. Amen. You're recognized by a denomination and you're separated by a denomination, but your denomination doesn't save you. You're saved because of what the book says. You believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and that's how come you're saved. You understand? Say amen if you understand. Amen. All right, so what happens when you get to the end of this thing? You have 1 Thessalonians 4. The Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, the voice of the archangel, the trump of God, the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive, you can check this, we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together to be with them, to be with the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. The last verse, wherefore comfort one another with these words. That's 1 Thessalonians 4, in the last part of the passage right there. What he's talking about is the rapture. The Lord stops up here, right along about where Brother Daniel's chest is here, and he stops and calls us out of here. That's the rapture. The second coming, which we're going to get to in a second, the second coming is the Lord coming all the way down and setting up his kingdom. We're not here to bring in his kingdom. We don't preach or teach that you get involved in political events so that you can wind up putting the right people in office to bring or bring in his kingdom. He's going to bring in his kingdom with blood. He doesn't bring it in, he takes it. When he comes, there's a battle that takes place. He doesn't get a popular vote. He demands, you follow me or I kill you. Yeah, he's a dictator. The Bible says he rules with a rod of iron. And he crushes anybody that doesn't agree with him. That's the Battle of Armageddon. Now, what happens here is during this time period, a lot of people are right now saying the four horses of the apocalypse, we've been through this all in the book of Revelation. This is just a review to catch the people up. In the book of Revelation, this is where your four horses ride. This is where your trumps, bowls, seals, and vials all take place right here. Every bit of that is in the tribulation. You say, where am I? I'm glad you asked. You're up here right here. Amen. You're up in heaven. Judgment seat of Christ, marriage supper of the Lamb. You say, well, it might happen when you come down. Okay, it might, but you might get a snack up there and then you might wind up down here later on. But bottom line is, judgment seat of Christ, when the tribulation's going on, you're up here in heaven. And you cross over after the judgment seat of Christ and get your white robe and you go over here to get your horse that's over there for you we talked about in the stable, and then you get saddled up and you come down with the Lord. That's where we're at here in Revelation 19. In Revelation 19, we're not back here. Well, preacher, what's so important? Why are you making such a big deal about that? Can I tell you why? Because most people nowadays are teaching that second coming is here, and that may put you out here where the tribulation takes place after Jesus comes. Well, that don't make sense. So then they say, well, this right here really doesn't take place. It all doesn't take place to here. Well, that doesn't make sense because that means the church is going to go through the tribulation. We know that's not true. Right? Because you're pre-tribulation. Don't take my word for it. Look it up. I've showed you the verses on it. You get hauled out of here before the tribulation. So Jesus can't come to take to for the second coming because the Battle of Armageddon can't take place before the tribulation period. And if you'll watch this, if this doesn't exist and they teach the great white throne judgment as well as the judgment seat of Christ are all the same thing, then you got another problem. That means the church is going to go through the tribulation when the Lord promised you as his bride that you wouldn't go through the tribulation. Now, that right there is going to separate you from 90%, forget all the other denominations, of a lot of Baptists nowadays. They're changing their theology.
Because all of a sudden world events are getting such that they're saying, well, maybe we were wrong about that, and maybe we're going to go through the great tribulation. You're not going to go through the great tribulation. The Bible says, in this world you shall have tribulation, but that doesn't mean the tribulation. That means you're going to have trouble. But don't confuse those two things. Make sure that you clearly understand that Revelation 19 is the second coming of Christ, where the Son of Righteousness, that's found in Malachi, comes down here with the healing in his wings. But the healing doesn't come until after he splits the Mount of Olives. And you have the Battle of Armageddon that takes place right here. And then the Judgment of Nations that takes place right there. And then after that, you step off into this thing for 1,000 years. At the end of that 1,000 years, Satan is loosed for a little season, and he comes up here to fight a battle. And here's the second problem. Before this great white throne judgment takes place, you got another battle that takes place right here at the end of the millennial kingdom. It's called the Battle of Gog and Magog. It is not the Battle of Armageddon. It is two entirely separate things. They take place at least 1,000 years apart. When the devil is loosed in Revelation 20 for a little season, he goes to the north country up there around Russia, and he gathers an army against the Lord to come against Jerusalem again. Now here's the odd thing about that, fellas. Hang on just one more minute. Are you doing okay? Hang on just one more minute. Here's the odd thing about that. During this time period, the Lord Jesus Christ has been ruling on the land. And you've had the wolf laying down with the lamb. You've had the sun shining 7 times brighter. You've had the harvester going in behind, the reaper following in behind the sower. There's land flowing with milk and honey. You have perfect peace. You have a perfect atmosphere. You have everything like the Garden of Eden. You don't have to worry about any problems. You don't worry about war and sickness and all that other kind of stuff. And yet somebody comes up and says, well, I don't like him ruling over us. And he's able to gather up a big enough army to come against the Lord at the Battle of Gog and Magog. That don't make sense to me, except that what the Lord is going to show you is that no matter how you do it, no matter what anything man puts his paws on, he's going to mess it up. So the Lord lets the devil go after 1,000 years, and he comes out, fights the Battle of Gog and Magog. The Lord destroys him with the brightness thereof, with the fire coming out of his mouth. And once that takes place, heaven and earth fold up right here. That's Hebrews chapter 1. What he does is he takes the whole universe off like a garment, and he folds it up and does away with it. That's 1 Peter chapter 3. Heaven pass away, the elements are melted with a great heat, pass away with a great noise, and there's nothing there but the great white throne. And at that great white throne, there's a judgment that takes place, and that's not just the judgment for the people in hell. That's the judgment of everybody that's been around since before Adam, all the way through to every human being and every angels. 1 Corinthians 15, know you not that you shall judge angels? What angels are you going to judge? The ones that fell back there and the ones that fell there and there. There's still a third of them, ladies and gentlemen, that hadn't fallen. Revelation chapter number 12 is future. It's not past tense. What they try to do is run all the way back over there to the garden and say, well, when Isaiah 14 took place and the devil went up, his angels went up there with him. No, those angels come from here in Revelation 12. They fall with him down to the earth. That means he takes his tail and draws a third of them after him. That means a third of the ones that are up there right now are going to follow the devil during the time of the tribulation. And you're going to see them coming out of the sky while you're going in the other direction. But that tell you anything about how deceptive Satan is? If he can fool angels? The angels have been around since God created them. The angels have been around and seen the cherubim and the seraphim. They've seen heaven. They've seen Calvary. They've seen all that kind of stuff. How could the devil be so deceptive? You better not mess with the devil. If people say, well, I'm equipped and I can handle the devil. Okay, help yourself. Me, I'm running to Jesus. If the archangel won't even contend with him, he's got some sense about him, then why should we be messing with him? So for those of you that are visiting, just to clarify just a couple of things to make sure you get it, this rapture that we talk about, that we all yell and shout about and we get excited about, and we do, and rightfully so, that takes place before the tribulation. Some of us here tonight are praying that the thing will happen before I get another word out. Amen. We're ready to go. Cut my suspenders and turn me loose now. And I wish it would happen now. That's called the rapture. The second coming, you're coming back with him. There's a guy recently that got on the radio, and what he was doing, he had you going up and running through the judgment seat of Christ and grabbing a horse and coming back down in less than an hour. Which I'm not sure how he even figured that thing out, but that's what he was said happened. He said, this idea, this foolishness about a rapture is the most ridiculous thing I've ever heard in my life. Why, you know the word rapture is not even in the Bible. You're right, it's not. It's called a catching away. You call it whatever you want to call it, but it means I'm going home. And when somebody wants to tell you that to make you think that because that word's not in the Bible, that the teaching's not in the Bible. The teaching is in the Bible. Oh, they didn't know anything about a rapture until 1800s when a guy named Darby came along. Really? Have you read your Bible? The Apostle Paul was here long before 1800. long before 1800. You know who else? We go all the way back to Enoch. That's in Genesis. You know what the Bible says about Enoch in the book of Jude? That the that when Enoch preached, he preached the Lord cometh with 10,000 of his saints. Preaching all the way back there in the days of Adam and Eve. Don't tell me that, that they just now came up with a rapture. You've lost your marbles. So anyway, that gives you an idea. Now, my wife had some of these things made up. I've already given mine away, but if we'll get you some more of them, some little small ones. If some of you got them, get me some color copies of it. But that's just the basic idea. So what we're going to talk about tonight for just a few minutes, I know I've probably taken way too much time here, but this is the time we're talking about right here. The tribulation's over, right at the very end of the tribulation period, and we're getting ready to come back with him. All right? And it's going to be a bloody mess. All right, I hope that helps you. Thank you, gentlemen. You can roll that or just lay it if you want to, and we'll worry about picking it up later. Now, I won't give you this whole thing tonight, but I'm going to try to give you just a few more things, and I did this morning. Come to Song of Solomon, chapter number 6. Song of Solomon, chapter number 6. Now, I do take this stuff seriously. It's not a joking matter to me. If you don't want to take it seriously, that's okay. That's your business. But I take it seriously because I believe it's where I'm going to live eternally. And I believe that's what I'm supposed to do, is proclaim the gospel. And to tell you about the spirit of prophecy that we talked about the other day, I'm supposed to tell you about those things. I'd like to ask you a question. How come some of you have been in churches for years and years and years, nobody ever told you about the second coming of Christ? They didn't tell you about the judgment seat of Christ? They didn't tell you when all those things were going to take place? How come they didn't tell you? Why didn't they tell you? You didn't need to know? They didn't know? It wasn't important? You going to the judgment seat of Christ is the second most important thing in your life. After you get saved, the next most important thing in your life is the judgment seat of Christ, where every man's work will be tried, whether it be good or bad. And what'll happen is when you get tried, you'll be tried for the work done in the body, whether it be good or bad. That's the second most important day in the world. You say, why? It all points to Jesus Christ. We'll give you these things here. We got some if you need them, right here if you want them. You don't have to take them. It's not a mandatory. We're not taking names, but you can have them if you'd like to have them. They're good charts for you. All right, now come to the Song of Solomon, chapter number 6. I don't understand that. I don't understand why people say, well, there's just certain things. One preacher said, there's just certain things they don't need to worry about. You don't need to worry about the judgment seat of Christ? I'm going to be the one in attendance there. I want to be up there, and I don't want you to be up there going, well, preacher, I never heard about this before. I want you to be up there. Well, at least he told me and gave me the option. If I didn't want to do nothing with it, that's fine. But at least he gave me the option. And if you don't want to do anything with it, that's fine. Or if you think I'm a nincompoop, then that's fine also. But at least you got the option. I don't understand. And a guy calls himself a preacher. He doesn't preach to you. The most listed thing in the entire Bible from Genesis to Revelation is the second coming of Christ. The Bible's been turned into nothing but a cotton-picking moral rule book for people to make you have a better life. Listen, the Bible's written about somebody more important than you coming down here and taking what he bought and paid for. Amen. Our eyes are focused in the wrong place. We become too carnally minded. We're too worldly minded. We're not thinking about out of this world. Well, you know how it is, preacher. You know, you get too heavenly minded, you're no earthly good. You must be running around carnal Christians. You can't be so heavenly minded, you're no earthly good. Why, look at Jesus Christ. He's the most heavenly minded man I ever knew. He did nothing but good. A man that is right with the Lord Jesus Christ will do 10 times the amount of work as an employee as somebody that's not, and be 10 times the husband or the wife, and be 10 times the right child or the right servant for the Lord. I think the more heavenly minded you are, the better person you are, the better citizen you are, and the more you matter. I don't care what office you have. I don't care what position you hold. I don't care how much money you got, how big a Ponderosa you live in. If you're right with God, it matters because it counts, because only what's done for Him is all that matter anyhow. Yes, you get all caught up in all your problems, all your difficulties, all your trouble. Me, 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 I. You'd think that cotton picking Freud came back around because it's all about the id, the superego, and the ego. No, that ain't what the Bible's written about. There's some things in there that would be to your benefit to do what the Bible tells you to do. Why? Because it draws you closer to Him and it points to Him. But it's not a rule book on how to get you out of trouble every time you messed up. Get right with God. That's an old-fashioned way. Well, I'll take 12. Take one. I'll take 12 steps. Take one step. Get right with God. I can save you the other 11. You'd be surprised what that would do for you. And I mean no offense to some of you been in those programs and stuff. I don't mean any disrespect to you. But I guarantee you this, if you would get right with God and let Him fill you like we talked about this morning, you wouldn't have a tenth of the problems you got now.
Amen.
The problem is you're not yielded to the Spirit, you're yielded to the flesh.
Amen.
When you get home this week, read Galatians 5. Read it about 10 or 15 times until it sinks in.
Amen.
Our problem is not God, our problem is us.
Sure.
Our problem is we're going to have no man to rule over us. Our problem is you ain't going to tell me what to do. Who do you think you are trying to tell me what to do? I'm my own. No, you didn't buy yourself. He bought you.
Amen.
He's got a right to tell you what to do. You just don't want to hear it.
Amen.
That's what churches are full of today. Some soft lace on their under drawers sort of a preacher get up and say, well now, you know, how would you like things to be today? And isn't it nice to have you here? And oh, we're so glad. I know you're all trying so hard. In my opinion, ain't none of us trying hard enough. I haven't met a saint of God yet that was really close to God that ever felt like they were really doing what they ought to be doing for God. Not one time have I ever met somebody living for the Lord that ever walked around saying, yeah man, I'm living for God. I'm doing everything. Follow me, I'm the poster child. The closer you get to God, the more humble you get. The closer you get to God, the more close to the realization you come that if I don't stay in tight with the Lord, I could mess up and be out tomorrow.
Amen.
Not lose my salvation, but be down there and with the pigs in the pig pen, get hog dewy all over me.
Amen.
See, it never happened to me. I was raised in church. You're more susceptible than ones that ain't. Amen. Because you take it for granted. It'll always be there. Oh, well, I'll just be there. The doors are always open. It's like I come because I'm doing them a service to come. Okay, whatever you want to think about it, but one day, buddy, when that horn blows and you get hauled up to the judgment seat of Christ, the Lord says, throw it in the fire. I ain't even going to listen to what you got to say. You notice at the judgment seat of Christ, no man speaks. You know why? The Lord says, your work will testify for itself. Throw it in the fire. I'm not interested in your excuses. I'm not interested in how theologically you can lay this thing out. I'm interested in one thing. What does the work say? Let it speak for itself. Throw it in the fire. If it's the real deal, I don't care how much you spun it and how much you talked it up and how much you thought it was great. If it's the real deal, it'll spill out and spit out gold, silver, and precious stones. And if it ain't, it'll burn like a bunch of black rubber tires. And us as Christians will be up there on our face and weeping and squalling saying, man, I wish it had been more real. I wish I'd have taken it more serious. I wish I hadn't got caught up in all the things of the world, the problems of the world, the stuff in the world, and the world, the world, the world, the world, the world. And the Lord said, heaven and earth shall pass away, but my word shall never pass away. Well, Lord, why'd you say that? To let you know where to focus. Focus on things that aren't going to burn up. Song of Solomon. I'm not getting on to you. I just get frustrated. I've been listening to this stuff, trying to study about the second coming. You almost can't find sermons on the second coming anymore. They talk about everything but that. And when they do talk about it, it's like the Lord's coming down here in a giant sleigh with a bunch of reindeer pulling it, except they got horses doing it, and He's coming down here and He's going to hand out candy canes and stuff and just kind of understand and forgive everybody. Not the second coming in my Bible. The second coming of my Bible is a time of war where the Lord judges in jealousy and fury. He wipes out everything in front of Him. Mows it down like on a sled, underfoot. I don't know why they don't tell you about that. It ought to scare you enough to say, if I'm not saved, I want to get saved.
Amen.
Song of Solomon. I haven't forgotten where I'm at. And I know you think I am, but I haven't yet. Song of Solomon chapter 6, verse number, 10. Song of Solomon 6, verse number 10, that's it. 9. My dove, my undefiled, is but one. One bride, not multiple brides. She's called a chaste virgin, not virgins. Anybody ever read Matthew 25? Matthew 25 is the parable of the 10 virgins. You remember that parable? Virgins, plural. They have to buy oil in order to be able to have the oil when the groom comes from the wedding. That's not you. Preachers are preaching Matthew 25 is you, that you're the virgins. No, you're not. You're a chaste virgin. And you've already been presented. When that takes place, that's somebody that has to have works in order to be saved when the bride returns, when the groom returns from the wedding.
Amen.
From the wedding. You're going to the wedding.
Amen.
All right, now watch what happens. You're the one going to be married. She is a choice one, O-N-E. She is only one, O-N-E, of her mother. She's a choice one of her, bear her. The daughter saw her and blessed her. Yea, the queens of concubines have praised her. That's Psalm 45. We've been over that. Who is she that looketh forth as the morning fair? Fair as the moon, there's the church. Clear as the sun, there's the Lord. And terrible as an army with banners. Terrible as an army with banners? Well, that's you. That's where we get the picture in our mind that we all line up out there with horses and we've gotten divided off by divisions and keep rank and that kind of thing. And everybody's got a division or a banner that they get underneath. That matches up there with Revelation chapter number 19. Hebrews chapter number 3. Hebrews chapter number 3. I try to move quickly here so you can grab this, but these things are very important for you. You say, well, it doesn't help me live tomorrow. I believe if you get to thinking about where you're going and could be tomorrow, I think you'll live better tomorrow.
Amen.
I really do. I think the more that you put your thoughts on the blessed hope and glorious appearing of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the Bible said, he that hath this hope in him purifieth himself. You don't want to learn how to live a clean life? You want to know how to live a clean life?
Yes.
Focus on him coming and catching you doing whatever it is you're doing when you shouldn't be doing it.
Amen.
Ask the Lord to fill you like we talked about this morning in Ephesians chapter number 5. Ask him to keep that stuff there and live every day as if you're going to hit the judgment seat of Christ that day. You'd be surprised the difference it'll make in your life. You'd be surprised the difference it'll make in your decision. If you knew the day of your death, would you think you'd change how you live? I heard one arrogant fellow say, no, I wouldn't change nothing I'm doing. I would. I bet I'd read a little more. I bet I'd pray a little more. I bet you there's things I allow to slip into my life now that if I knew I was going to kick off tomorrow about this time, I bet you I might tighten up a thing or two. I mean, maybe I wouldn't throw my cigarettes and liquor down or something like that. Maybe I don't have that to throw down or mess with. But I bet I'd be a little bit more committed. I might be out on the expressway passing out tracks, you know, trying to get one more before I got out the door or something. Throw a little bait out there on the water and hope that after I die, all of a sudden the Lord hauls me in there and says, well, they finally read the trek and prayed the prayer, so we'll go ahead and give you a reward for that one. I might be, you know, fly up in an airplane and dump a whole bunch of them out. I don't know what I might do. But if the Lord were to tell me I'm coming tomorrow, I bet I'd tell somebody about the Lord coming tomorrow instead of just saying, yeah, well, I'm sleepy. I'm going to go home and take a nap. I bet you if the Lord was coming tomorrow, I bet we'd change some of the things. I'm not so arrogant as to believe that I'd be like Luther. Luther was a very holy man, very righteous man. If you knew Jesus Christ was coming tomorrow, what'd you do? I'd plow my taters. Well, what's he saying? He'd say, I know I'm doing everything God wants me to do, and part of what God wants me to do is plow my taters. So I'd go plow my taters. Well, I don't know that I could say that. Am I doing everything God wants me to do? I try, but when it comes under the microscope of God's judgment, is it really what it ought to be? Well, if it is, praise the Lord. Good. Good for you. But for me, I need a constant check.
Amen.
I need to check it. The world can get you divided. You get your mind off of your things like you just get all twisted up and messed up and get to thinking whatever it is you're living for and working for down here is all that matters. One day, the problems you got will be gone in the twinkling of an eye.
Yeah.
One day, you'll get hauled up there and all your family members you're worried about and all that, if they're saved, guess what? Then their problem's going to be over with. And if they're not saved, there ain't nothing you can do about it anyway. Help them if you can help them. I'm for you helping everybody if you can help them. But I'm for keeping your eyes in the right place. Remember me telling you about Paul down there, me playing the mule and him pointing to that fence post and him saying, don't take your eyes off that fence post. Don't worry about where you step. I'll watch where you step. If you're about to step on a snake, I'll knock the snake in the head. You keep your eyes on that post. And then you get to the end of that thing and get ready to turn around and go the other way. And that line just as straight as it can possibly be. How's that possible? And I got one leg shorter than the other. It stands to reason I'd walk in a circle. But I don't because of where I keep my eyes. You know why some of you walk in a circle all the time? Spiritually, you got one leg longer than the other, and you're always looking where you've been, you've always been looking what you're doing, you've always been looking at this, instead of looking down there at Jesus Christ and say, there's the author and finisher of my faith, I got my eyes on him, I don't worry about all this other stuff. I think you worry too much about your reputation. What's somebody going to think about you if they do this and they do that, and so on and so forth? Who cares? You get up there, your reputation not going to be able to say nothing. If you clothe the same, look the same, act the same, all that other kind of stuff, the Lord will delineate rewards that will point back to him. And guess what? You'll be conformed to his image. You lose your image. You say, why? Because otherwise we'll be comparing ourselves among ourselves, which is not wise. You ladies will be looking at somebody that's got black hair and you'll want blonde hair, and somebody that has blonde hair and you'll wonder why they got black hair, and you'll be wondering why she got curly hair and I want straight hair. She's got blue eyes and I got green and I wanted blue, and she got brown and I got this. And you guys will be comparing arm size and chest size and all that other stuff. The Lord said, I'll just fix that whole cotton picking mess. I'll make you all alike. You'll be as the angels. This might be over a few off your head here, but I don't intend to be. As the angels means everywhere in that Bible where an angel shows up, those angels show up, they're male. You'll be conformed to His image. What are you so worried about retaining your identity for? Woman power? I'll tell you what ERA is. Eve ruined Adam. That's funny. Y'all aren't very laughable tonight. You're kind of giving me that. Ladies and gentlemen, what you got to understand is that what you see down here is not real life. What you see down here is not eternity. What you see down here that you get so wrapped up with and consumed with, it don't do you a bit of good when you get ready to kick off. And when somebody you know has already passed on, all this stuff down here, they don't help you. What matters is where they're going and where you're going. That's the only thing that's different from you and everybody else. Go ahead and kill yourself from working for the man, and then when you kick off, they'll leave more for them to argue about. Right. They think, well, you know, I want everybody to know that I loved you all equally and that kind of a stuff and all that kind of stuff. Well, the Lord ain't like that. Right. The Lord loved all of you equally at Calvary. I'm fixing to get you upset now, so go ahead and get ready for it. The Lord loved you all equal when you came as a sinner. You're all equal as a sinner. But He don't reward you after that the same way. Amen. He rewards you according to what you do. Everybody don't get an equal inheritance. It's based on what you do, and He doesn't reward bad behavior. What are you getting nervous about? What are they going to think? What do you care? You're dead. What do you think? They're going to show up and tell everybody, ruin your reputation after you're gone because you didn't give them something you think they ought to get it? Where'd you get that? That's unrighteousness. The Lord doesn't reward unrighteousness. Have you read your Bible? That's 1 Corinthians 3 and 2 Corinthians 5 and Romans 14. That's the judgment seat of Christ. That's the Lord judging every man according to what he hath done in the body, whether it be good or bad. That means the Lord rewards you based on what you did for Him. It has nothing to do with, I'm going to show my love equally. That's communism. You don't even pay people. Amen. You don't even pay people the same across the board. You pay different people different things. Until this other mess got going, and it'll eventually be gone away if it goes the way of Europe, and they'll pay a heart surgeon the same thing they do as a regular general practitioner. Well, something's wrong with that. You have to put in 4 more years after your regular residency and all to even become a heart surgeon, and then you've got to have a residency as far as a heart surgeon. It takes, generally speaking, 14 years to become a heart surgeon over and above your regular. Well, the guy's done the time. He should be able to get paid a little more. Oh, well, one doctor's the same. You go ahead and let a GP operate on your heart. You're dealing with somebody's ticker, man. That's a lot different than saying, well, you got a sore throat and you got a runny nose and you got a case of the flu or you got a barnacle on your foot or something like that. No, you're working on my ticker. But you know where it's going to go is, or where it's going to go, and modern theology says, and well, you know, there's no difference in Him. There's no respecter of persons and all that. There is to Him. You know what the Bible says about the Lord? The Lord looks over there at the apostles and he's got 12 of them. One of them's the devil, so he's got 11. Out of 11, he's got 3 that he's in an inner circle. He treats them differently. He takes them up on the Mount of Transfiguration. They get to see the Lord transfigured. He lets Peter walk on water. He lets John see the revelation. You know what he says about John? The apostle whom Jesus loved. He shows John things he doesn't show anybody else. How unfair is that? You know why the Lord does that? Because He knew where John's heart was. You know what He says about David? I don't know why I'm on this, but it's good for you to grab a hold of it. You know what He says about David? David said, the Lord liked me. You know what Abraham said? I'm God's friend. What's God say about you? He's kind of choosy, isn't He? Don't you think that's prejudicial? You know what He's doing? He's rewarding them based on whether or not they love Him. And if you love Him, He gives you more. If you serve Him, He gives you more. Everybody don't get the same thing. If somebody dies, they just trusted Jesus Christ. You take them by the hand, shake their hand, say, listen now, if you want to trust Jesus Christ as your Savior, you're about to die now. Why don't you trust Jesus? Well, I've always rejected Him. Okay, well, good. Don't reject Him now. You go to hell now, straight as a bullet. Why don't you? Well, I never had a chance to do anything for Him. Okay, fine. But at least you can go to heaven. Better to go to heaven and be with the saints up there than to be in hell burning forever. And so the guy says, I will, if you'll squeeze my own, trust Jesus Christ. Okay, he trusts Jesus Christ. Dies, goes straight to heaven, as from the body present with the Lord, and gets up there, and the Lord said, throw it in the fire. He goes, throw what in the fire? I just got saved. And the Lord says, well, I love all of you equally, and I don't want anybody to think I'm being prejudicial in my way of giving out inheritances. So I'll give you the same thing as the Apostle Paul, who lived his whole life and spent his entire life and then died in the faith serving me. I'll just give you the same thing because I wouldn't want anybody to think I'm unfair. Really, how come two of those passages I gave you, ladies and gentlemen, this morning said that they that are guilty of doing these things shall not inherit the kingdom of God? How come it says in Galatians chapter number 5, if you walk in the flesh, you don't inherit the kingdom of God? He doesn't mean you lost your salvation. He means you lose your inheritance. Well, that doesn't sound very fair. Well, if you're a child of God, why don't you get an equal split across the board? Because God don't reward unrighteousness. That's why. Don't you understand that? That makes him unholy and unrighteous. That makes him saying, well, because you're my kid, I'll overlook you being wicked as the devil and living for yourself after you got saved. He don't do that. You're not in a competition with each other. You want to get his attention. Lord, I love you. The Lord says, okay, nice, talk's cheap. Let me see if you love me. Put it in the fire. If you loved him, it'll show. And if you did, he'll give you a reward. And if you didn't, he won't. Because he's not a man. He's not like other people down here that, well, you know, I just want everybody to get the same thing. You don't all get the same thing. It don't work that way. A guy that's been around 20 years, it stands to reason the guy should get more money than the guy that's been there 2 years. Well, they're doing the same job. Uh-uh. You don't know nothing about that guy that's been there 2 years. Let's see if he can last another 18. That guy that's been there for 20 years has proven himself. He's a good horse. Keep putting your money there. But nowadays, in modern corporation, you know what they do? They come in and say, well, the guy's working for 2 years, so we can get a guy for 2 years instead of the guy 20 years. I'll take the guy for 20 every time. Amen. You say, why? He's got a track record. He's got history of loyalty. Been plenty of chances for him to leave, and he stayed. I don't know nothing about this 2 year punk that's here. I ain't going to pay him the same I pay a 20 year man, and I'm not going to, so I can help my business bottom line, I'm not going to go ahead and cut the 20 year guy and put my faith and trust in a 2 year guy. I ain't doing it. Now, if you want to do that, that's fine, but that's not how the Lord deals with things. Right. Look at this thing in Galatians 5. I'll come back to this thing in Hebrews here in just a second. I don't know why we're on it, but I guess it must be a good thing. Y'all got mighty quiet right there. That modern theology nowadays that comes around, it says, you know, well, you know, we just think, you know, everybody at all to get the same thing. That's communism. That's socialism. Amen. That's eliminate the middle class. That's take from the rich. That's called Robin Hood. Anybody here ever seen or read the book Robin Hood? I'm not going to get you. Anybody in here ever seen Robin Hood? You know, splits the arrow, knocks the apple off your head and all that kind of stuff. You say, well, who hadn't? These kids nowadays probably hadn't. That's one of the greatest things on communism that was ever written. You say, why? Well, it's painted up to look good. What it's painted up to look like is these poor indigent people over here are being mistreated, so the poor indigent people go rob the rich people, and they take from the rich and then give everything to the poor. Now, I'm for the part where they take away from the Catholic Church and, you know, from the taxes of the Catholic Church. I'm for dispensing the wealth there. I think that's good. But what Robin Hood does is he goes down there on the Sheriff Nottingham's, you know, property and shoots his deer and does his stuff. Hey, man, the law is you don't shoot the man's deer. You think God would do that? I guess some of you think that must be a story in the Bible somewhere from the looks of your faces right now. Isn't Robin Hood in the Bible? Yeah, the Lord came down here to steal from the rich to give to the poor. You don't find the Lord breaking the law one place. Isn't that strange? Can I give you a suggestion here? Here's the Lord. What has he got? I don't know. Foxes have holes. Birds of the air have nests. The Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. The Lord says, you want to follow me? You ain't going to have no house to live in. The Lord says, the rest of the world's got it, and I don't have anything. I don't have a camel to ride on. I got to borrow a donkey. I'm so poor, when I die, I got to borrow somebody else's tomb. And you think that the Lord's going to divide up the prosperity among the people? Where'd you get that? Who told you that? You think if you're spiritual, God's blessing you? Let me show you how God blesses you in this age. You suffer. The blessing God gives you is trouble. Because up there in eternity, trouble spins. And down here, filthy lucre spins. Trouble don't spin down here, does it? Boy, you want to pave the street up there? They pave the street with the stuff you worked so hard for here. The Lord says, you want something up here that amounts to something? If you suffer, you'll reign. Look at this thing in Galatians, for those of you that are new, so that you understand. After you get saved, we're talking about the judgment seat of Christ right now. After you get saved, ladies and gentlemen, one of the things you got to realize is you ought to get to work. Not to get saved, not to stay saved, but because you love Him. Amen. And so that when you get up there, you're not only naked and ashamed, but you got something to show for what you did, because you can lose your inheritance for living for yourself. Amen. Galatians chapter number 5. Good night, man. Watch what the Bible says here, verse number 17. Flesh lusteth against the Spirit, Spirit against the flesh. They're contrary, the one to the other. You cannot do the things that you would. Forgive my speed, but you are led of the Spirit. You're not under the law. Now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these: adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft. I read it a time or two. Hatred, variance, emulation, wrath, strife, sedition, heresies, envyings, murders, drunkenness, and such like. Watch it. Here it is. Verse 21. Of the which I tell you before, as I have told you in time past. In other words, I've not just told you once. I've told you about this before, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. You know what he says? If you're going to walk in the flesh, you don't lose your salvation, but you can lose the inheritance. You don't get to rule and reign with everybody else. Well, I just felt like that the Lord would just reward everybody the same, and we'll all have a little cabin on the hillside, and we'll just all be up there having us a good time with our banjos and our violins and all that. You don't get what everybody else gets. After you get saved, it's based on what you do. You want to rule with him, you got to suffer down here. You want an inheritance up there, you have to quit living after the flesh. There's not a better reason in the world other than it displeases God for you to not live after the flesh. Every time you do, you're spending your inheritance.
Amen.
Every time you live after the flesh, you just knocked it off up there and you don't get what you could have got. That's a good reason. Money motivates you down here. Why doesn't it motivate you eternally? Boy, God's got our number, don't he? The Lord says, well, if you really believe there's going to be inheritance in here, you always want to be in charge of your inheritance. You can't stand to be stiffed in the inheritance, right? I've watched them fight down here at the nursing home before. I've sat in the room, they're down here, they're fighting, all they want's my money. They just want my money. I mean, they just can't wait for me to die so they can get my money. I'm telling you, I'm not going to give someone. I mean, just bitter, mean, in the last days of their life, worrying about holding on. I'm not giving any of them anything. They're blessed God. They're not going to get anything like that. I'm going to tie it up in this. I'm thinking, good night, man. Get over yourself. You're fixing to die. What are you going to do with it? And then some of you think about that down here, but you know what? You're not doing anything for that up there. You've lost sight of what's important. You still got time. Turn and burn, man. Go get them. Put the pedal on the metal. Do something for the Lord now while you still got a little bit of time. He said, well, preacher, I got stuff going on. The Bible says, and all that you do in word or deed, do all to the what? All right. So get busy about doing it. I don't care if you're running a soundboard. I don't care if you're playing an instrument. I don't care if you're preaching. I don't care if you're coming. Be the best person that comes as you can. Be faithful in coming. Nowadays, people feel like, I ain't got to go to church. I can watch it on the internet. I don't need to worry about going to church. I got too many other things to do. I don't need that. That's the falling away, man. Until the Lord fixes it and puts a chain on it where I can't come, and I'm coming. You say, why? I figure the Lord will figure it out when I get up there. Just a few things I might be able to do for him. If nothing else, my neighbors think I'm a nut. Okay, well, that's good. And where he's going again? He's going back out in a coat and a towel. Where do you reckon that fellow's going? Oh, he's going back to church again. Okay. Nowadays, they wouldn't think nothing of it if you go to the ball game. You know what I know? I know some people, these cat people, the football team, I can't remember, Jaguar people, right now, they're fixing to spend $60-something million on redoing a stadium, and you got a losing team, man. And I thought to myself when I saw that, $62 million or something like that, and I thought, man, that's a great deal. You can play to lose and get $62 million. They give you a bigger stadium and everything else, and you're losers. Wow, what do you do if you win? But I thought to myself, there's some people, you know what I heard a fellow say the other day? Walmart. You know what I heard a fellow say the other day? He said, yeah, well, they may be losing, but I ain't missed a game. I like to have some Christians with that in them. Well, things may not be going good, but I ain't missed a game. I remember that old woman I told you about back there, Miss Lovelady. I remember Herbie sitting right over here where Matt's sitting. I remember Tommy where Brooke's sitting right there, sitting next to Herbie, about that far apart. Both of those fellows had mental deficiencies and those kind of things. And Miss Lovelady, I mean, man, if she didn't have Alzheimer's, I don't know what she had, man. I mean, she arteries had to be so hard she about break when she walked. And I'll never remember those people as a kid. I never remember missing a church service. And nowadays you have to coax people and ask people and beg people and all that kind of. I've gotten where I don't worry about it no more. What's the point? If the Holy Spirit can't convince you, then it's like, well, the preacher just thinks I ought to be there. Well, if you don't think you ought to be here, don't come. Really, why force you? You're going to come with a bad spirit if you do. If you don't think you need to be here, okay, fine. Try that tomorrow, though, when you get up and go to work. I don't think I need to be there. I can do as good a job at home as I can do anywhere else. I'm just going to stay at the house and see how long your business lasts. Why don't you let your employees do that? Just let them call in tired.
You say, "Preacher, I am tired." I know you get tired. I understand that. I really do. And I appreciate that. But not every week. I don't get that. Let's just call it like it is. You want to call the baby ugly? You're willing to sacrifice your life and all the energy you have in your body for the world and for the things of the world. But when it comes to the Lord, you just give him whatever you got left over, and that's it. And that ought to be good enough for him. If you don't like it, tough apples. And some of you have been serving the Lord for years, and now you figure, well, I've already put in my time, so I'm right here at the end of this thing. And you know what you say? I've done my time. Let some of these whippersnappers do it. Am I telling the truth or not? Am I in the Bible? The Bible says a great falling away. Seducing spirits. Stay at the house. You ain't got to go down there to be spiritual. I'm wore out with hearing that. You don't have to go to church to be spiritual. What an attitude. Well, why wouldn't you? Like the guy told me a few meetings back. He says, "I just don't believe you got to go to the altar to be spiritual." You're right. Give me some verses on the altar. And I said, "I'm just going to give you one comment." He, "Well, I figured you would." And I said, "Okay, I wanted to say smart aleck so bad, but I didn't." After you talk like I do, you have to just take it, you know. And he said, "Well, I figured you would." And I said, "So tell me, what does it hurt for you to come to the altar? If you can answer that for me, then I'll give you the verses on it." Yeah, he looked at me like you're looking at me. What's it hurt for you to humble yourself and come to the altar?
Right. Amen.
Don't hurt you at all. It's good for you. Build character in you. It also lets this cotton picking thing right here know, if you do that again, I'm going to drag you down there in front of everybody else, and I'm going to show them again how wicked you are. And you better shut up behind and behave yourself.
Amen.
I'll drag you down there come Sunday. I won't even wait till he's done preaching. I'll drag you right down there. You know what that flesh will say? Okay, all right, okay. It's good for you.
Amen.
You try to convince people nowadays. I don't know, some people here got upset about reading the Bible. That's Laodicea if I've ever seen it. "Preacher, you know, we just ain't got time to read the Bible. You're putting pressure on us to read the Bible. If you really was led of the Spirit to read the Bible, you would read the Bible. You don't have to be guilt-tripped into doing it." My. Well, if you were led of the Spirit, I guess you'd be reading it more than you'd be reading your email.
Amen.
That's good.
Don't you just give it enough to give it more time than you give your email? Or how about this one? Your television set. See, you don't like that kind of stuff because it kind of shows you what you really are and shows you how the lack of commitment you have.
Right.
The only reason some of you people ever stop watching television is if they have an EMP thing here or blow out all the power and you can't watch it. Then you'll be going around, "Man, I ain't watched television in 30 days. Yeah, you ain't had no power either. Well, how about take a day off from it? Yeah, just take a day off. Just turn it off. We're having to turn the TV off day. Whew, man, I must be preaching or something. Everybody's upset now. Well, now, wait a minute, preacher. Well, no, I'm just saying, you give the Lord. Try it on Sunday first. Yeah, that's what I thought. A lady said to me one time, she said, "I don't have time to read my Bible." I told you this illustration before. My wife got a thing with a paragraph, I don't know, honestly, seriously, about that long, typewritten, double space and all that, about a number 8 or 10 font rare, and of all these addresses of people she's sending all this email jokes and stuff to and all. She got time to do that every week and every day. "You ain't got time to read your Bible? Okay, fine, no problem. Lord, I didn't have time to read my Bible." The Lord would say, "Throw it in the fire. Quit you talking. Don't want to hear it." "Well, Lord, I just want you to understand, I was real busy. I'm tired of hearing you talk. Throw it in the fire." Well, but Lord, you have to understand, some things more important, you know, and all this stuff about being, just shut up and put it in the fire. You don't think he'll talk to you that way? That Bible said when he speaks, it's like thunder and lightning going off. It's like Niagara Falls running. That thing's like him. The Bible says when he spoke, it, some said it thundered. And when he speaks, I'll guarantee you this, it won't be like some little old grandpa saying to you, "I'm just so glad you're here, and I just think you're so wonderful, and I think you're so marvelous." He's going to talk. When he talks, your very being's going to shake. He made and created every molecule that makes you up. You'll be in front of him. You won't be pulling the stuff you pull now. The reason you do that is to try to soothe your guilty conscience or try to pull somebody into the foolishness with you. You don't want to be committed? Fine, no problem. But I'll tell you this, if you don't want to be committed, you know what will happen? When the time comes and things get tough, you know what you do? You'll throw in the towel so fast it'll make your head swim. You'll even surprise yourself at how easily you are offended and how fast you quit. You say, "Why?" You're not committed to the cause of Christ. I never said a word to you about what you ought to be doing. except read your Bible. How about prayer? That's a good one. You praying more than 10 minutes a day? I had a couple things come up in the past week or so and called a couple of folks. And I said, listen, I could really use some prayer. I called some people I felt like would really pray. I said, well, you should have called me. Well, maybe I didn't know whether you would really pray. I'm not trying to be harsh with you. I was in a jam. I needed some wisdom. And for me, that takes somebody better get through quick. I guess I've offended you now. Should have called the whole church and told everybody, y'all pray. I don't mean to offend you. I'm simply saying, does your wife or your husband know that you can call them and say pray and you can get through? When's the last time, fellas, your wife heard you pray out loud? Ladies, when's the last time your grandkids or your kids heard you pray out loud? All of us. Me too. Easier for me, I'm a preacher. But what about you? You got to walk with God, but you never talk to Him? That's your chance to tell the Creator of the universe anything you want to tell Him. You don't take advantage of that? Why not? I'm just asking. You don't have to be mad at me. Become your enemy because I tell you the truth. I guess it's good I've got to go preach a meeting somewhere because from the looks of y'all are ready to tar and feather me. But ladies and gentlemen, I'm here to tell you there's something more at stake. I can teach you all the stuff out of Revelation, but 99% of the stuff I'm teaching you in the book of Revelation doesn't have any bearing on you. You're not going to be here. Amen. What's more practical and important for you is the stuff you got this morning and what you just got tonight. You say, yeah, but you think I'm rough on you? You think how you think it's going to be when you face the one that died for you? You think he's going to look up there and say, well, you know, they probably can't take it. You'd be in a glorified body then. And you're going to take whatever he dishes out. And I hate to tell you this, but it must be something terrible. You know why? Because Paul says, knowing therefore the terror of the Lord, we persuade men. You know what else Paul says? Paul says, Onesiphorus hath often refreshed me. The Lord have mercy on him in that day. What's he talking about? The judgment seat of Christ. Well, if you're helping the preacher out there, I would think you'd come out okay. You know what the Lord said? Man, I sure hope the Lord will have mercy on him. What is that? That's real church. It should challenge you. Should make you kind of break the rust off. Make you kind of feel like I need to do a little bit more. Pump up the tires a little bit and get it cranking, get it running again like it used to run. Get some prayer time and get some preaching time and get some Bible time and stuff like that. And you'd be surprised. You might have a real revival. The Lord might really do something for you. Sure. And I can tell you this, if we don't, she ain't going to last much longer. She's coming apart at the seams right now. The reason is because people don't want to be told that. You know why? Because you're so far above most other religions and other people that you feel like you're doing okay. And you're in a real dangerous position when you get like that because you think you've arrived. And you think you're ripe. And the fact of the matter is, you ain't ripe, you're rotten. None of us has arrived. Not one. So you don't know that about me. Unless the Holy Spirit is, unless the Lord Himself is here, there ain't nobody arrived. Ain't anybody in here in the image of Christ yet? You have fully, completely, totally the mind of Christ about all things? Why aren't you down here washing people's feet? Why are you still bitter and angry and upset? If all the people would be upset, it would be the Lord, wouldn't it? You know, all the attributes I gave you this morning, all the stuff I told you, the Lord doesn't do that stuff. He didn't harbor all that. He's full grown. He's got it in proper context. Now, if you want to do something for the Lord, I encourage you to do it. And if you don't, nobody can force you to do it. I'm not one of them preachers going to try to guilt trip you into doing it. Because why? It won't last long. But if the love of Christ doesn't motivate you, then I guess you just can't be motivated. So if you don't want to serve, then enjoy the ride. See you when we get there. But if you want to do something, pray and say, Lord, what would you have me to do? All right, let's stand together and be dismissed.